Hey everyone, it's BlueLizardJello, and welcome back to Everything Possible in Dark Souls 1, and this is Episode 9, where we will be taking on the Catacombs. But before we do that, we do have a few things to consider. Number one is our choice of weapon when we go into the Catacombs. Because we picked up the Divine Ember after fighting the Moonlight Butterfly, we can now give it to Andre so we can upgrade any plus 5 weapon into a Divine Weapon. And we're going to do that now, and the weapon that I've chosen is the Great Club. I'm using this because it's something very different than what I'm used to, but also because it does blunt damage, it does extra damage to skeletons. So once we have it to plus 5, we can then ascend it to Divine using the Ember we gave to Andre. And because we have so many green Titanite charge from the slugs down in Blighttown, we can go ahead and upgrade this to plus 5. Now we're doing this so that we can kill the skeletons in catacombs without necessarily worrying about the necromancers, and it also does extra damage to certain enemies including the four kings. But now it's time to show you what I'll be wearing. So, I've decided to showcase not only the new divine weapon, but also to show you how poise works in my own video. So, what I'm wearing is the Eastern Helm, and then the armor, the gauntlets, and the leggings are all part of the Elite Knight set because they have some of the best poise at this stage in the game. Now, I could be using the stone armor if I really wanted to max it out, however, it was just a bit too heavy for my liking. So here is the current build that we're going to be running with, and then I'll show you my stats. Most importantly is that I got my intelligence to 15 so we can talk to Big Cat Logan in Firelink Shrine and buy his spells if we wanted to. And then also notice we are now at 86 poise. That is up from the 5 that we had previously. And that is absolutely going to make a difference. So before we actually head into the catacombs, let's make a quick stop into Firelink Shrine so we can talk to Big Cat Logan, as well as an NPC who has also moved there. So here he is sitting down next to Griggs. And if you have less than 15 intelligence at this point, he will not actually allow you to purchase any of his spells. However, once you've obtained the Lord Vessel from Anne Orlando and you place it in Firelink Shrine, then Big Cat Logan will actually move to the Duke's Archives. When you meet him in Duke's Archives, you do not need to have 15 intelligence in order to buy his spells. By the way, you are going to want to buy all of his spells if you want to see his questline through to the end. We'll see that later in the Duke's Archives. So once again, before going to the catacombs, we do have one more person to speak to. But in order to talk to him, we do have to jump over to this bridge. You may remember that in episode 1, we jumped over to this bridge so we could obtain the Ring of Sacrifice off of a corpse. But now hanging out with that corpse, we have Domnall of Xena.
Aishimite. Didn't expect to meet anybody here.
So the reason we're talking to him is because after you've rung both Bells of Awakening, he now sells a few different items. He has the Master Key, and he's going to begin to sell certain boss armors. In this case, he is selling the Iron Golem set. As you defeat various bosses throughout the game, Domnall will begin selling some of their armor, and we'll be talking about that as we kill those bosses. Keep in mind, they can be pretty expensive, so if you're looking for anything particular, you may want to consider saving up. But that will do it for Firelink, so now let's go ahead and run through the graveyard, showcase some of the moveset of the large club, a weapon that I've actually grown quite fond of, thanks to the practice runs I made with it as well as the actual recording of this video. Having a moveset that is largely overhand can be very useful in many situations, unless the ceiling is rather low, which we will see in the catacombs a few times. But this skeleton dropped the scimitar for us. We're going to see a few scimitars drop as well as a falchion. Now they are very similar weapons, both curved swords that can be dropped from the skeletons, and either weapon, when in the hand of a skeleton, does bleed damage. However, the weapon does not have any bleed effect when it's actually wielded by the player. So if you're looking for a bleed build, do not go for the falchion or the scimitar. And here we have an introduction to a new enemy type. These are known as wisps. They are the floating skulls that we'll see here in the catacombs as well as in the new Londo ruins. They don't drop any items, they do not give you any souls, but they do have, as you can see, a very large AoE explosion that will do massive damage to the player as well as any surrounding enemies. But here is just kind of a quick look at the entrance to the catacombs. You can see the pile that we just landed on is nothing but skulls, bones, and various body parts from enemies that have been slain down here. But here's the old R1 to R1 combo with the large club, which has tremendous range, and I absolutely love it. And here's our first falchion, and yet another scimitar already. Now the falchion, if you're going to wield it in your offhand, does have a parry animation. So if you are looking for something other than a shield in order to parry, the falchion could be a good choice. And I stopped to take a look at that statue just to give you an idea, because we're going to be comparing that statue to a few others later on. There is a subtle or somewhat subtle difference between the two statue types you'll find. One will do damage, one will not. Also in the catacombs, we're going to find a couple of these doors as well as some bridges that need to be turned, and you have to be on the lookout for certain lever mechanisms in order to activate. Here's the first one, and also here's our first necromancer. The necromancers are carrying a skull lantern that can actually shoot a fire projectile at you, but more importantly, the necromancers can revive any skeletons in the area that you've defeated, unless you've killed them with a divine weapon or a weapon with a holy modifier. That is why we are using a divine large club, that way if we can't get to the necromancer before we actually fight some skeletons, the skeletons will go down and they'll stay down. So now that we've rested at this bonfire and we've gone ahead and kindled it, so we have those 10 Estus flasks. Kill these skeletons one more time. You can see this corridor lined with these innate statues. And then once we get to the top of this hill, if you have a bow, which I recommend that you have one for this area, now we can actually go ahead and snipe this necromancer. And even though he will attempt to shoot his fire projectile at us, because we have the high ground, we're actually relatively safe. So at this stage, even if we didn't have a divine weapon, we could run forward for a little while, feeling confident that the skeletons that we kill are actually dead. But you can see right here, as I'm taking hits from the skeletons, I'm still able to hit them because of the poise of 86 that I got from this armor set, as well as equipping the wolf ring. This is going to be hugely beneficial for the catacombs and numerous other areas in the game, but I wanted to showcase it since it's not a build that I often play, just in case you had any further questions on how poise worked. So instead of being stunned when I get hit, I'm completely unaffected. Yet another scimitar, hooray. Now your poise can still be broken. It is not impossible to be broken out of poise, however it does take a lot. You will see an enemy or several enemies later that are very easily able to break my poise. You can probably already guess what those enemies are if you play through the catacombs. And here's a failing rolling R1, and here's the riposte. Absolutely brutal. I have practiced this run several times in order to get the most optimal route, or what I feel is the most optimal route, and yet that never happened to me before. And here we have the Lucerne. The Lucerne is a halberd type weapon, and all of the attacks are actually thrust attacks. It doesn't have any slashing. So this weapon is one of the best weapons out there in case you want to use the Leo Ring, which you can obtain by defeating Smo and Ornstein, fighting Ornstein last of course, later on in Anne Orlando. But we will talk more about that ring when we pick it up, but keep in mind if you're looking for a good thrusting weapon, especially one with reach, the Lucerne is a great weapon to have. Slowly and methodically clearing this area, don't forget this item here, which is a large soul of a nameless soldier. We're not even worried about these archer's arrows, but we'll take him out. Then one more skeleton. And now we can finally clear this area. And we can head outside, and we're going to see our first example of a bridge covered in spikes that we can't cross. This would be one of the ones that we have to look for a lever in order to rotate. Once again, we do have a necromancer at range, so we can't snipe him. However, you are about on equal ground, so even though it looks like he can't hit you, as you can see there, he clearly can. But once again, if you did not have a divine weapon, killing that necromancer from range would allow you to now kill all the skeletons in this area without worrying about them coming alive. Or you can kill the necromancer at range, you can actually use the wisps to kill most of them, or you can use their own suicidal thoughts. And here we're going to look at the statue again. And you can see that this one looks a little different. Obviously the spikes are an addition, but if you take a look at the head and you take a look at the stomach, you can actually see that this statue is wearing the mask of the mother, and it also has the mask of the child in its stomach. And if you see those masks, spikes will come out of the mask of the child. Here's the lever that controls that bridge. You can see it rotating out in the distance. And then before we run across it, we'll come back here and grab this soul item. This would be Soul of a Proud Knight. and if we look directly above us, there's an odd-shaped hole in the ceiling. We'll actually be crashing through that in just a few minutes. The reason I don't normally play this type of build is because, my goodness, you are slow. And the rolling is pitiful. Now these skeletons, if they're on the ground, whether you knock them down or they fell on their own accord, they can be struck when they're just a pile of bones. Use that as an opportunity to deal a killing blow. This first enclave has a single skeleton in it. The rolling R1 has great tracking if you're using the analog stick to use it. And then this Soul of a Proud Knight, you can get it just like I did without taking damage if you go to the left of the statue, and you actually stay as far away as you can while looking for that pickup item indicator. Also, the large club was chosen because it actually has some pretty good physical defense when you're blocking. Here's another door similar to the start of the catacombs. We'll be looking for a lever in order to open that. First, we have this room with three skeletons. That might have proved to be a problem had I not had such a far-reaching weapon. No big deal. And now we have this pincer trap right here. I decided to roll through it in order to pick up this Soul of a Proud Knight, but you can actually walk to it if you just stay directly in between those two statues. We're going to continue down this spiral staircase. I was really hoping that he would roll off, unfortunately not. Now you can see that the large club is actually hitting the ceiling here, but as long as it still connects with the enemy, unlike there, you still will do damage. Here's our second necromancer. Do a rolling R1, followed by a regular R1, and we were lucky enough to get a skull lantern drop off of this necromancer. Skull lanterns are a somewhat uncommon drop from the necromancers. By the way, there are only 6 of them and they are non-respawning, but you can get one for sure in the Tomb of Giants later on. We push that switch there, but before we go up and actually go into that door we've now opened, we're going to continue down the pathway, and if you look below, you can see faintly there are a few platforms. The first platform you get to just by walking off. The next one, even easier and a shorter fall, again, just walk off. Do not roll, do not jump, walking off is sufficient. Grab the green titanite shard on this corpse before making the plunge all the way down. And then you can hear a blacksmith in the distance, so let's go ahead and drop down and see who it is. This is Vamos the blacksmith, and you can only access him if you fall down through that hole first. If you do not, that wall that he just destroyed would be intact and you can't get through. Now he doesn't sell anything particularly interesting and nothing that we can't get elsewhere, however, he is the only blacksmith in the game that can actually give you the fire enchant. And once you pick up the large flame ember and the chaos ember, this is the blacksmith you want to give it to. He sells homeward bones, titanite shards, and then an array of arrows and bolts. And that's really it. However, if you decide to kill him, there are 2 items that you can get. You can get Vamos' hammer, and you can also get the royal helm, which is a rather Viking looking helm. Both of those items can only be acquired by killing him. New monster. Here's our first glimpse at the bonewheel skeletons, but we're gonna nope right out of there, so we can go ahead and find more loot before we go down to that absolutely horrific area. Now we're going to go ahead and speed this up because we do this run a few times and I don't want to make you sit through it on normal speed every time. It's pretty much a standard affair of just block attack, poise attack. Yes, I left an item back there, but I'm fairly certain it was just a scimitar, so I don't really need it. We are going to pick up one item that we haven't seen so far yet off of one of these skeletons, and that would be the red and the white round shield. Nothing too special about it, it's pretty average in all respects, but if you're looking to collect all the items, this is where you get that particular shield. Now, heading across this bridge and dealing with these two skeletons, instead of going straight and going into that door we opened, we're instead going to take the right path. And even though it may look like a dead end, you can see that a patch of dirt here looks a little off. And as soon as you land, you can see a couple of sparklings in the distance. Those aren't items. Those are actually a pair of crystal lizards. Now you can see I was able to hit one and stagger it, but I still have to finish it off. And in doing so, I get two twinkling titanite and two white titanite chunks. But the other one is gone. If you want to make your crystal lizards respawn, go ahead and quit and reload your game. And they usually will reappear. If they don't reappear the first time, go ahead and quit and reload until they do. We're going to be using that tactic a lot in the Great Hollow, where there are no less than 10 crystal lizards to be found. And that second crystal lizard, you may have noticed, gave us another pair of twinkling with titanite and a white titanite chunk. Climbing up this ladder, we're going to find another hole that we can drop through. And now, you should recognize this area. Where we just fell through is the area that we looked at in the ceiling that looked a little weak, and this is the lever that we used in order to rotate that first bridge. So we will fight through some of these skeletons, make our way back to that bridge, and continue on to the door that we opened previously. Once again, we'll go ahead and try to use these wisps to our advantage. Just run by the skeletons, get their attention, and let those floating skulls do what they do best. Wonderful. Once again, we're at the spiral staircase, so we're going to use the same moves we used earlier, rolling R1 here, which is excellent in tight quarters, that way you don't have to worry about ricocheting off the walls or the ceiling. R1 to R1 here, and as long as you're pointing in the direction of the second enemy when you're spamming that next R1, you will change direction mid-swing. Now, I just showed you those stairs. We're going to be using those as a shortcut a few times in this video, so you want to remember where they are. But before we go too far ahead, we do want to find the second bonfire that is hidden in the catacombs. And if you take a look, this wall may not look quite right, so I'll roll through it because there is also one of those trap statues. But here is the second of two bonfires in the catacombs. It's kind of strange that they put one so close to the first one, and especially since it's not a very large area to begin with, but I'm definitely appreciative of the bonfire. You'll see why a couple times, actually. Next, we do have another bridge that has spikes on it, so we're looking for the lever. At the top of this ladder, we'll find the lever to rotate the bridge, and we would have seen Patches here. However, he's not here because Rhea and her group are already in the Tomb of Giants. There are two requirements in order to see Patches here. One, Rhea and her group could not be in the Tomb of Giants, and you have to have Pinwheel alive. Now, Pinwheel is alive, but because Rhea has already moved, Patches is not there. Don't worry, because if you want him to be a vendor later on, seeing him in that location is not required. So now before we actually cross that bridge to the fog gate, we're going to take care of the skeleton. And we're going to go back to those stairs that I showed you earlier. And then if you get close to the edge and you look down to your right, you can see a platform that you can easily just walk onto. And another one that you do the same. And now we're above where the first necromancer was, and we've picked up the Great Scythe. As mentioned before, if you are looking to make a bleed build, the Great Scythe does have bleed buildup. It also has a B scaling and dexterity, and it has a fairly decent moveset. So once you pick this up, give it a few swings, see if it feels right, because I find it to be a very versatile weapon. Once again, we're gonna drop through the floor here, and we have a couple of options. We can go up that ramp, or we can go inside that hallway. We're going to take the ramp first, but before that, once you see those skulls or you hear those skulls starting to explode, run away, block if you can. I use the hallway in order to save my own skin. But now we're going to head up this ramp, deal with a few more skeletons along the way. Very easy with a Divine Large Club, I may add. Making our way up here. I'm surprised I didn't actually get parried there. But that's okay, I'm not complaining. When they're in the parry animation, go ahead and either do a kick or a jumping R2 in order not to get parried. But you can see a very, very suspicious looking wall. We'll be checking that out momentarily, but just so you have your bearings together, I want to come up here and activate this fog wall. So you can see that we're now on the other side of that bridge that we just rotated moments ago. And now you have the connection. So let's go back down to that wall, and it seemed like something was on the ground, and since we're playing offline, this can't be a player message. Treasure, without any sort of rating system. If you see a message while you're offline, or if you find a message that has no rating system whatsoever, that is a developer message trying to give you some assistance. In this case, they're telling you that, hey, if you go through this wall that can clearly be broken down, there should be treasure ahead. I'm climbing up this first ladder just to show you how to take out this second archer. You could take him out from range, or in certain circumstances, he will actually fall down on his own accord. But we'll deal with him since we're already up here. Now you cannot get back this way, but on the ladder opposite, if you take a look, once you get on top of this ladder, you are higher than the entrance, so you can hop down and get back the way you came. It is not necessary because if you follow this path, you can get back to nearly where you started. Here's our first look at a giant skeleton. We will see many more of those in Tomb of Giants. So instead of one swing, it takes two. Not a terrible deal. And now, inside this sarcophagus sitting in front of this statue, we pick up the Dark Moon Seance Ring. This ring has two effects. Number one, putting it on will give you an additional attunement slot. So if you're not looking to put points into attunement, you can rush to the catacombs to get this ring in order to get a free slot. The other thing it can do for you is that there is an illusory wall we'll see in Anor Londo, and wearing the Dark Moon Seance Ring in front of the illusory wall in Anor Londo will cause it to dissolve, so you can actually join the Blade of the Dark Moon Covenant without having to kill the false image of Guinevere. We'll go ahead and show both methods once we're in Anor Londo. If you keep just making your way up to the top, first we're going to have our next necromancer here. Deal with him rather swiftly. Poise right through his attacks, take out the skeleton. Now we have another developer message telling us to go up in front of a ladder, so it seems to be a very fitting message. And since we've already followed one that says treasure, I guess we can follow one that says up. Unless they were just recommending that movie Up, which was really good, but really sad. I think they meant for us to come up, but I'm probably going to watch Up later anyway. Anyway, get through these statues, and now we get the miracle Tranquil Walk of Peace. Now we've already seen this effect in place when we fought the giant stone knights in Darkroot Garden, but this spell will actually cause any nearby players to have 50% extra encumbrance, which means that they will typically be moving slower and they may be unable to roll depending on their current burden weight. And by now you should recognize where we just dropped into. This is the first building here. So we're going to slowly make our way through, we'll kill the enemies along the way. Because next we have a rather large and imposing enemy that has caused us troubles in the past and is going to cause us troubles in the future. Or I guess at this point, the present. But you can never really be in the present. Have you ever noticed that? Think about it. The present doesn't exist. You have the future, which is upcoming. Okay, understandable. You have the past, which is already behind us. But the present can never actually be experienced, because as soon as you even say the word present, that moment has already become the past. Man, I should talk to Jaden Smith more often. Anyway, showing you that you can run off this bridge onto the stairs, which provides a shortcut to these platforms. And now we can drop down this hole again, because that hallway we saw earlier, this is when we're going to investigate. And you can already see his form materializing down at the end. We have our next Titanite or Prowling Demon. Now this particular Titanite Demon's HP is a little bit less than the two higher echelon Titanite Demons we fought in Sin's Fortress, but it is higher than the ones we originally fought, so we'll take some time in order to take down. You can use a ranged strategy, but instead, after I take a look at this coffin, which we'll be exploring momentarily, I decided I will go ahead and go to my Claymore +10 I'm going to use lightning pine resin, or gold pine resin, excuse me, in order to do additional damage. And then in order to cap that off, we're going to go ahead and use power within so we can get that extra damage. And in practice, this method worked flawless. In actual execution, this method worked horrendously. So here I am one-handing my weapon like an absolute fool, knowing full well that had I been two-handing, I could have actually staggered him by now. But with my health already dwindling, I decide instead of going for the heal, maybe I can just tough it out. But then Power Within says, na-na-na-na-na-na-na. And I died. Yeah, I know. Skipping the run back for you, we're now back at the demon. We're gonna try the same tactic again and hope it fares just a little bit better. And hope I remember to two-hand it. Top off the health. Ignoring the bloodstain for now, because I figure I can just make quick work of him. But that hit says otherwise, as does that one. And now I'm already beginning to panic. Try to go for the stagger, does not work, he almost gets me with the plunging attack. And now I realize I need to play a little bit more defensively. So we heal up a bit, dodge his lightning attack, try to dodge that plunging attack, but I can tell you that my timing I don't think has ever been correct on dodging that move. Not to mention these rolls just make me sad. In fact, there's a great video that highlights what I think this roll would look like in real life, so let me go ahead and post that in the description below. So if you want to see what I think I look like, go ahead and check that out. Gold Pine Resin is now run out, but he is nearly dead. So I decide why not take another plunging attack to the back of the neck. I mean, not doing anything else at the moment. Top off health, go in for the running R1, take a hit, but you know what? He's dead, and that's all I care about. He drops another Demon Titanite for us, and then behind him, on this corpse, something that if we didn't pick up already in the depths, we would want to get now for sure. And that is a trio of Eyes of Death. You saw that we investigated a coffin before the Titanite Demon, and now we're actually going to hop in, and if you don't have an Eye of Death, this won't do anything for you. But because we do, and thanks to the magic of editing, I can skip the about 30 seconds it takes for this cutscene to play, we're going to go ahead and transport somewhere a little different. And no, for you Dark Souls 2 players, we will not come out as female on the other side. I still have no idea why that decision was made. Seriously, why would I suddenly want to change genders after playing the game for all of 2 minutes? It's lost on me. But you could see a skeleton close the coffin and seem to have transported us away. And as soon as we wake up and step outside, the area's going to look vastly different. It won't look too different for long, however, because we're going to be visiting this place again the next time we have to encounter Gravelord Nito, which may not be under such amicable terms. But we are now technically in the Tomb of Giants, and in this giant sarcophagus you can see this writhing mass, and if you remember from the opening cutscene, this is Gravelord Nito. So we're going to join the Covenant. Now keep in mind that I have already abandoned the former Covenant by talking to Oswald of Kareem, so the former Covenant leaders won't actually be upset with me. But joining the Covenant gets you the Gravelord Sword, and you also get the miracle Gravelord Sword Dance. The Gravelord Sword is one of the two weapons in the game that actually has a toxin buildup, so that can be very effective. And the miracle Gravelord Sword Dance is a miracle that causes many swords to come up all around the player in a large area of effect, and it does massive damage. However, if we want to get the upgraded version, we are going to give 10 Eyes of Death, so I did spend some time in the depths farming the Basilisk, and once we get to 10 Eyes of Death donated, our rank will upgrade in the Covenant, and then we will actually get the Miracle Gravelord Greatsword Dance, which does even more damage. Now you can continue donating Eyes of Death to the Covenant, and your miracle damage will increase, however there are no other items to get. Keep in mind that you will keep the Gravelord Sword and the two miracles even if you do leave this Covenant, but the damage of the miracles will be reduced to 90% of their former power. But in order to get back up to the Catacombs, all you need to do is sit in the coffin one more time, and we'll be transported back up to where we began. Here we are back outside of the coffin, and we are going to go ahead and switch to our old build because the large club is just too much fun. And we're going to continue on as if nothing ever happened. I will try to showcase those miracles in a future episode. Coming through this broken wall, go ahead and pick up a large soul of a nameless soldier before heading down. And if you're observant and you take a look at what's below you, you do have a couple of skeletons waiting. We're going to go ahead and kill them both with a plunging attack, because style. But if you make enough noise up top, they will actually climb the ladder to get to you. And we'll be taking a closer look at those suspicious looking floors in just a few minutes. Before we do that, go ahead and head down this ladder. It makes no sense that you're able to slide down that, considering there's actually no handrails on the side, but I digress. We have our next necromancer here, guarded by a pair of archers. But thanks to the wonderful world of poise and armor defense, we can just run in there with an R1, take him out. We actually get a second skull lantern, which is actually not a terrible thing to have, considering we can trade one to Snuggly for the Ring of Fog later on. And now just another glimpse of where we're at. That was the pit below that has all the bonewheel skeletons in it. We are not going out there yet. In fact, I wish we never had to. But we're going to go back up the ladder and take a look at those two floors that had those suspicious looking patches on them and see what happens when we step on them. Patches as in being an area of a different material, not patches as in the hyena, but you probably understood that already. And when you hop down, get ready to either dodge or block. In this case, I do neither, because we have our next Black Knight to fight, and this time he's wielding a great axe. The fight is rather similar to those with the greatsword, so we're just going to go ahead and block and wait for our opportunity to backstab. You can parry them, however I was feeling particularly vulnerable this time, so instead we backstab him to death. We actually get the Black Knight greataxe, and we also get the guaranteed drop, which is a white titanite chunk. Looking down into this valley of death and despair, grab ourselves a soul of a proud knight here, and now I'm going to show you the bonewheel skeletons up close. If you are a Dark Souls 2 player and you've never played Dark Souls 1, you may think that the bonewheel skeletons are no joke, because hey, you fought them before when you fought the skeleton lords. Well, allow me to introduce you to Dark Souls 1 bonewheel skeletons. Goodbye poise, goodbye armor, goodbye HP, because I am no more. And that's how quicken can happen, even with the defense that I have. I did not show you the run back to my souls, and I did not show you me homeward boning back instead of actually fighting those enemies, but rest assured, as you can tell by my soft humanity and my soul count, I did retrieve them safely. But as far as the main area of the catacombs is concerned, we are just about done collecting items. So now we're going to use this shortcut again. As I said, we use it multiple times. Make sure that we don't have any wisps to contend with, and we do, so let's go ahead and get them to explode. One more. And now we're going to go to where that wisp just was and look down. Because what we want to do is very slowly, very carefully drop straight down. And as long as you're human, and as long as you actually survive the fall, you can get a large soul of a nameless soldier. Okay, to be fair, it doesn't matter if you're human or not for that, but if you're human, you can now summon Paladin Leroy. And I wish we got to play with this phantom more. Tarkus is great, don't get me wrong. He can solo the Iron Golem very easily. Paladin Leroy is just an absolute beast, and we don't get to see him in action very much. But before we actually see what he can do with the bonewheel skeletons and the boss of this area, very carefully walk down right where that notch in the rocks is, so you can actually pick up the holy set, which contains the priest hat, holy robe, traveling gloves, holy trousers, which might be my new catchphrase, and a mace. Now if you started as a cleric, you have all those items other than the priest hat, so if you want that cute little head adornment, make sure you pick up that item. Here's Paladin Leroy using Wrath of Gods, absolutely fantastic. And he will also tank these bonewheel skeletons like there's no tomorrow. So with his help, these actually become quite easy to deal with. Granted, having a really good shield like a +10 Balder shield doesn't hurt either. Now these enemies do have an uncommon drop, and they will actually drop the wheel itself, which will function as a shield. The shield can do some pretty impressive damage when you actually use it as a weapon. In fact, I've seen shields only runs that will use the bonewheel shield, and the game is actually not overly difficult with it. So a lot of people have some reasons for actually coming to the catacombs very early on in the game. There are some upgrade materials, there's the Dark Moon Seance Ring, you can get the Black Knight Great Axe, and you can get a Bonewheel Shield. All of these items could be gotten within just maybe 5 to 10 minutes of starting the game if you know the correct routes. But here we are, coming up to the boss of Catacombs. One of the easiest, if not the easiest boss, granted the Moonlight Butterfly is pretty darn simple. But just for fun, we're going to go ahead and use Power Within and see what kind of damage we can do with our large club. Mr. Leroy, hop down, let's go ahead and say hi to Pinwheel, shall we? So here is Pinwheel. Pinwheel is wearing three masks currently. He is the mask of the father, the mother, and the child. You have a chance of getting one of those as a definite drop from him, and the others, if you'd like, you can purchase from patches once he becomes a vendor. I'm only talking about these items because talking about the fight itself seems somewhat trivial, because as you can see between Paladin Leroy and I, it's not a very difficult fight. Now that we have the Rite of Kindling, we can actually kindle any bonfire up to 3 times, so we can have up to 20 Estus Flats at a time. We also get a Humanity, a Homeward Bone, and in this case, we get the Mask of the Father. So of course, what else do when you get the Mask of the Father? Well, you equip it right away, and you start on your journey towards becoming a giant dad. And that is exactly what the rest of this playthrough is going to be, ladies and gentlemen. I'm absolutely kidding. There is no way, shape, or form I will ever, ever act like a giant dad. You mark my words, never. Are you listening? Never. Anyway, Catacombs is now behind us, with the exception of one item that we will get thanks to some developer messages. And before we take that route, let's go ahead and take a look at the Skull Lantern and see what kind of light we can produce with it. Once I sort through all this, I promise, I will go through my bottomless box before the next episode. But you can see it lights up a significant area. But this is the Tomb of Giants and we're not quite ready to go here just yet. Besides, when we do come here, we're actually not going to be using the Skull Lantern. You may have already guessed it, but we're going to be using the Cast Light Sorcery, that way we actually have both hands free for combat. But following these developer messages, this will actually lead you back into the catacombs, so if you weren't quite ready for the Tomb of Giants and you didn't have any homeward bones, which doesn't make sense because you just got one from Pinwheel, but you can use this method, pick up a Soul of a Proud Knight, and then you're ready to hop back down and do it all over again. And anyway, guys, that is the catacombs. Thank you so much for watching. If you learned something, leave me a comment and let me know what. If I missed something, you have to leave that comment as well. But anyway, I will see you guys next time.